So, the ice is not innocent, since there are also some intermolecular forces, and the temperature finally influences our way of tasting. With the cachaça is easy. A caipirinha is not a caipirinha without cachaça. This is clear. They make some drinks with vodka, with sake, with rum. Also, then you end with tasty drinks, but not with caipirinha. But this has to do with the content. This has to do with the content of cachaça made from sugarcane. And also there are some compounds in that are not contained in the other bottles. This has been proven by food scientists, and you can read it in the literature, that cachaça contains distinct compounds that influence the taste and altogether make the unique taste of caipirinha. So we made supramolecular, suprabar chemistry with a very common drink in Brazil. What can we learn from this funny example? We can learn it is not enough to know about one component of your supramolecule or of your drink. You must know about all components, or you must have the experience just to make the correct composition by intuition. So let's stay with the basic concept of caipirinha. You need fenchon, you need saccharose, you need frozen water with interactions, you need eugenol and ethyl guaiacol. But back to chemistry. Back to chemistry in a comparably old story. I want to speak exclusively about an old-fashioned ligand system, that of benzoyl thiourease. They have been proven to be versatile ligands for different transition and also main group elements. And when you inspect the Cambridge structural database, you have about 100 structures with these ligand types. And most of them follow this pattern. You have bisquilates with 2+ metal ions. This holds true for the transition series, holds also true for some main group elements. Only in some exceptional cases, you have the thiourease coordinated as monodentate ligands, just doing that what their name promises, to be a thiourea, not to deprotonate, not to form a chelate. This is made with copper one, with gold one, and 2 or 3 more rare examples. The normal kind of chemistry is this one. Also this cis coordination is not unusual. There are 2 or 3 more examples where this thiourea has been extended to a phthalo-type ligand system. And also here, the general chemistry does not change. You have square planar coordination geometry with copper, with nickel, with palladium, and everything that I've discussed for the bidentate ligands holds true also for this extended ligand. But when we saw this ligand, we thought there is an option. There is an option to extend the ligand, since here is a big hole. Why not using this big hole for a dry metal complex? Why not extending this ligand type to ligands that we call extended by benzoyl thiourease, simply by exchanging one of the carbon atoms here by a nitrogen atom to have a pyridine type central unit? You can extend in another way, and that you use the 2,6 picolyl compound, then you also have a central unit, but here the space is much more narrow, and in most probably this coordination geometry will form 2,5 coordinate, 2,6 coordinate compounds in one plane. The second opportunity for extension is to go away from the pyridine and to go to catechol-type ligands. Here, the expected hole in the center should be even bigger. Let me come to the concept. To the concept, one basic concept which is taught in the first year chemistry classes is that of hard and soft acids and bases. This type of ligands provides that. We have soft donor atoms, sulfur donor atoms in the outer sphere. We have a medium base with the pyridine nitrogen, and we have two hard donor atoms with the oxygen. This might invite metal ions to coordinate to distinct sites, not randomly. We want to control the reactivity. With this type of ligands, we have the same different hard and soft donor atoms, but in a different shape. We have three medium nitrogen atoms, two sulfur atoms, and the same finally holds true for the catechol type. So when we invite metal ions, what might happen? Soft metal ions may coordinate to the sulfur in the way that we have seen for the non-extended benzoyl thiourease, and we can establish the coordination number 2 and have the residue open for further reaction. In this case, metal ions with large coordination numbers are invited. Coordination number 1 in this hole, or 7, when you consider the axial position as additional donor positions. So when we do this as a chelate, then we have coordination number here, finally following the basic rules of the non-extended benzoyl thiourease, or 6 together with the axial positions. With this, we have one more empty hole in the center that can be filled by a bigger but harder metal ion. Since here we have just oxygen donor atoms and 2 nitrogen donor atoms. So to our basic concepts, hard and soft acid and bases, also the concept of coordination number of metal ion can be accompanied. So we have a kind of toolbox that we can use to play. Another aspect we should consider is the size of the cavity. Here it is simply defined. When we design such compounds, it is defined by the space that is formed after the chelate formation in the outer sphere. So we will meet borders with respect to the size of the central metal ion, but we have one opportunity with this catechol type ligand systems to make it even bigger. When we here coordinate in the outer sphere, nickel, copper, palladium, then we have a bigger cavity inside, and this size of the cavity may allow to coordinate one very big metal ion, lanthanum, or 2 of them when they are not so big. So this is just paper chemistry, this is just sandbox chemistry, and now we must come to reality and check if all the ideas that we have can be brought to reality. And we started, and this was not very smart, we started with the tellurium chemistry, and we had to learn this is not so easy, since some other basic concepts of chemistry interfere our plans. But let me come to the example we can learn from this. We reacted this type of ligand with a tellurium 4 compound, phenyl tellurium tribromide, in different ratio. This plays a role. And we also used tellurium tetrabromide. The results were from time to time unexpected. Unexpected for the first glance that in my imagination tellurium 4 should be relatively hard. So I expected tellurium 4 preferring the central part of the molecule, but what we see from the result, when I have these nice colored pictures, all those are results of crystal structures. Just to make clear that I do not want to tell it anymore. All these results are structural results. We have suitable crystal structures to all these compounds, and in the most cases also sufficient NMR when possible. Most of the compounds are paramagnetic. NMR, mass spectra, and infrared and elemental analysis. But I focus to the structural chemistry. What happened with tellurium 4? For me, unexpected, but when I discussed it with tellurium chemists, they say this is not so unusual. This happens from time to time that they coordinate to sulfur. The sulfur atom was served with coordination, and we get this mononuclear complex with a tellurium 4 atom at one sulfur atom. This was controlled by the stoichiometry of the reaction, so it was not absolutely unexpected. When we change the stoichiometry of the starting materials, we end with a different product. Look what happens. This tellurium unit is reduced, becomes a tellurium 2, and is coordinated by the 2 sulfur atom. This is more or less expected. I didn't expect it as an intramolecular bonding. I expected a bonding by 2 ligands. But finally, the chemistry can be understood. A weak metal ion, a soft metal ion with soft donor atoms, and the reducing agent finally was the ligand itself, since as a side product we isolated oxidized ligand. So this is an internal redox control. This is, of course, a cationic compound that finally is compensated with the charge by this counter ion on the basis of tellurium. The same type of compound is formed also without the phenyl ring, so this is not mandatory. It is also formed when we start from tellurium tetrabromide. We have an internal coordination of one tellurium atom between 2 sulfur atoms. Here the charge compensation is done by the bromido ligands. And again, we isolated yellow crystals of the oxidized ligand. So we have from our concepts hard and soft acids and bases, and redox chemistry interfering this concept. And we have another effect I did not yet mention. We cannot be sure if not even such weak interactions between tellurium and the central nitrogen atom might play a role by the establishing of this chelate compound, since the chelate formation itself doesn't play a role with this large chelate ring. So we do not really know if not a weak interaction with these nitrogen atoms makes it possible that the ligand is organized itself in this way. We thought we have understood something. We have concepts, coordination numbers, redox chemistry, and hard and soft acid and bases. Then we began to play, since we wanted to make olinuclear complexes, and so we mixed the metal starting materials. We did not only make the reaction with tellurium tribromide, we added nickel acetate, copper acetate, or manganese acetate. In all 3 cases, the same type of structure was obtained. And we're interested and keen to see what is formed by this reaction. What is formed? It is a bimetallic compound formed where the nickel goes to the central unit